Thank you very much, and thank you all for coming out on this chilly night, which I understand is not quite seasonal. So I'm going to tell you a story today about an extremely moral person, an animal rights activist in his 40s. And his name is Aaron Pitkin, but I should tell you right at the outset that this is, in fact, a pseudonym. And the fact that I'm using a pseudonym is itself a whole other story. Because here is a man who lives exactly as he believes he ought to. Not only does he have incredibly high moral standards for himself, but he sticks to them. And my book is about extremely virtuous people. So why does he need a pseudonym? He asked me to use one because he was worried that telling the story of his moral life would make him look so weird that it would interfere with his ability to do his work. He says there are people out there connected with the meat business who want to undermine his credibility, and he doesn't want to give them any material. Now, I don't know anything about the meat business, so I don't know if he's being a little paranoid, and he himself is not sure. But the point is that he believes that living a very moral life can make a person look crazy, and he is not wrong about that. I began this book by talking to people who donated one of their kidneys to a stranger, and I was astonished to discover that many of them had encountered a lot of skepticism and even hostility for doing so. I didn't expect that. I was talking to them wanting to know what sort of person would do such an extraordinary thing. They found that family members were very angry. They say, why are you donating to a stranger? What if I need a kidney? What if our children need a kidney? Friends thought they were just bizarre. And the doctors involved in transplant centers thought they must be nuts. And in order, I don't know if anyone here has tried to donate a kidney, but if you try, you have to go through a barrage of psychological tests designed to make sure that not that you're not being coerced by someone, but also that you're not insane. And while I was working on this book, I talked to a lot of people about this project and the extremely moral do-gooders I was interviewing, and something like half the people said, oh, they're all mentally ill, right? And I said, no. But I became quite intrigued by this reaction, and so it turned out that I spent a lot of the book investigating it and trying to analyze where it came from. Now, the key word here is extremely. The kind of person I'm talking about is not someone who's really nice, but otherwise normal. It's not someone who volunteers in a homeless shelter and then goes home to an ordinary family life in the evenings. I'm talking about people who think about even the smallest decision in their life in moral terms, who almost never asks themselves, what do I want, but only, what should I do? And why do such do-gooders make us uncomfortable? One reason may be guilt. Nobody likes to be reminded, even implicitly, of their own selfishness. And another is irritation. Nobody likes to be told, even implicitly, how they should live their life. But that's not the whole story. There's a quote I love from George Orwell in an essay he wrote on Gandhi. And Orwell greatly admired Gandhi, but he felt ambivalently about him. He wrote, "The essence of being human is that one does not seek perfection, that one is sometimes willing to commit sins for the sake of loyalty, that one does not push asceticism to the point where it makes friendly intercourse impossible, and that one is prepared in the end to be defeated and broken up by life, which is the inevitable price of fastening one's love upon other human individuals. It is too readily assumed that the ordinary man only rejects sainthood because it's too difficult. But many people genuinely do not wish to be saints, and it is probable that many who achieve or aspire to sainthood have never felt much temptation to be human beings." Ambivalence towards do-gooders also arises out of a deep uncertainty about how a person ought to live. Is it good to live as moral a life as possible, a saintly life? Is it good to bind yourself to a severe morality that constricts spontaneity and freedom? If you're really a committed do-gooder, you're not just giving away spare bits of money and time to strangers. You're devoting your life to them, and that will inevitably prevent you from giving everything you want to your own family. This, not petty selfishness, is the deepest conflict for most do-gooders. But is it right to care for strangers at the expense of your own people? It seems to me that these questions can't be answered in the abstract. Only actual lives convey fully the beauty and the cost of a certain kind of moral existence. So back to our animal rights activist, Aaron Pitkin. When Aaron Pitkin was a young man, he searched for a cause to devote his life to, and the answer he came up with was chickens. It was basically a numbers game. The vast majority of animals killed for food were chickens because they were so small. The meat-to-life ratio was terrible. And what factory farms did to chickens before they died appalled him. The birds in chronic pain most of the 6 weeks or so they were alive, so fat their legs couldn't hold their bodies up, sitting in their own feces, covered in sores. Aaron realized that if he could figure out a way to make chickens' lives better, then the quantity of suffering he could eliminate would be many times greater than in any other way he could think of. It wasn't that he thought chickens were more important than people, or more innocent, or more moving. He cared about them because they were more helpless and more brutally trodden on than even the most oppressed people. Their suffering was greater and their situation more unjust. He didn't spend time pondering how happy a chicken in better circumstances could really be. He wasn't interested in happiness. He was interested in pain. Although he made animal suffering his life's work, it didn't affect him much emotionally. When he heard about some new terrible abuse, or even when he saw some horrifying footage, half the time his immediate reaction was to think, fantastic, this will be great for the cause. There was one video of a beef slaughtering plant in the Midwest in which the abuse of cows was so pornographically sadistic that it made him cry, but that was rare. Aaron works at a large animal rights organization and has been an extraordinarily effective chicken advocate, helping to bring about a dramatic change in both laws and attitudes. He's a vegan because he believes it's the right thing to do, but he's not a purist about it. He's a pragmatist who believes that relieving suffering is more important than adhering to principle. For this reason, he believes that he should probably eat meat when he is meeting with cattlemen, he sometimes also works on cows, in order to prove that he's not some marginal zealot, but a regular Joe whom they can deal with. The trouble is that if anyone from the movement saw him eating meat, his authority would be irreversibly destroyed. He thinks of the example of a famous animal rights activist he'd heard about, who was an awful person with a coke habit given to sexual harassment and waving guns about. But the thing that really scandalized his followers was that he was rumored to have been eating M&Ms. True, the people who raised hell about the M&Ms were a bit crazy, but they were Aaron's base. He needed them to do his work. Aaron decided in high school that it was wrong to eat meat and he ought to be a vegetarian, but it took him 6 months to become one. Every day he would get off the bus and go to Hardee's and eat a bacon cheeseburger and feel terrible about it. Sometime later, he visited a place called Farm Sanctuary, an organization that rescued animals from agribusiness, and he discovered that animals were harmed in the production of eggs and dairy too, so he decided that the only defensible position was to be a vegan. He thought, boy, I am going to miss ice cream, but I have no choice. In college, he decided to dedicate his life to social justice. His initial plan was to work as a doctor in the Third World. And then he read an essay that changed his life, the philosopher Peter Singer's article, Famine, Affluence, and Morality. Singer compared the way most of us live to seeing a child drowning in a shallow pond and refusing to save him because we might ruin our clothes. Even if we don't see a particular child in danger, he argued, if we spend $200 on clothes that could have bought life-saving medicine, we're still responsible for a death. After he read Singer's article, everything Aaron bought, even the smallest, cheapest thing, felt to him like food or medicine snatched from someone starving. No one would buy a soda if there was a starving child standing next to the vending machine, he thought. Well, for him now, there was always a starving child standing next to the vending machine. He became very, very frugal. He went dumpster diving for food. Every time he spent money, no matter how little, he would write the amount down in his notebook. Aaron now knew he had to donate as much money as possible to international aid. That much was clear to him. But what else should he do? He decided that animals were more oppressed than people, and among animals, the ones lower down the food chain, the non-mammals, the ones that weren't smart or cute, were the most oppressed of all. Nearly everyone cared about dogs and cats, and many people cared about rabbits and cows, but very few people cared about chickens. At first, after making this decision to focus on animals, he made a point of spending some time each year in the library reading anti-animal rights literature in order to test his principles, to make sure there wasn't some compelling argument out there that would lead him to change his course. He wanted to be rational about it. After all, he was choosing animal rights work for logical rather than emotional reasons. But after a while, he became convinced that he really was on the right track, and he stopped doing this research. It wasn't as if the rights of farm animals conflicted with the rights of humans. Eating less meat was good for human health, it was good for the environment, and the undocumented immigrants who worked at slaughterhouses were some of the most ill-treated and miserable workers in the country. After he decided that animal rights were going to be his thing, he began to see suffering animals everywhere. Once in college, he was rushing to get to a final exam in a course he really needed to get into graduate school, and the exam was a major part of his grade. But it was raining, and worms were coming out of the grass and wriggling onto the paths. He knew that if he didn't pick them up, someone would step on them and crush them to death. So he stopped and picked up the worms and put them on the grass, and he was late. Then, at the end of the exam, he was racing to finish the last question. He had the answer on his calculator, and he was just about to write it in his book when the examiner called out, "Pencils down." Of course, the other students were still scribbling away, and he had the answer on his calculator, but he put his pencil down. That was a turning point for him. Before that day, he had believed in absolute principles. Never lie, never cheat, never this, never that. But when he thought of himself in that exam, putting his pencil down while everybody else was still writing and getting a worse grade than he deserved, which might have prevented him from going to graduate school and doing his work, all because of some idiotic, pompous sense of principle, he cringed. Being ethical was not about being pure, he realized. It was about caring about suffering. From then on, he figured out the moral thing to do, not by consulting inviolable principles, but by thinking about consequences. Yes, it was generally better to be honest, but if Anne Frank is in your attic and the Nazis are at the door, you lie. During graduate school, in slivers of spare time, he sought emotional relief from the school's amoral isolation by working at charities. He arranged his classes so he could volunteer at Food Not Bombs on Fridays. That was awful work. He got up before dawn on a frigid Boston morning to show up in a tiny alley with excrement everywhere, to lift box after box out of a van until his knuckles bled, and then he'd toil down in a hot basement kitchen making meals. The fun part was serving the meals and seeing the faces of the people getting the food, but he usually left before that. He figured there would always be people willing to do the fun stuff, but only he was willing to do the bad part, so he would do that and go on to something else. When he was in his mid-20s, Aaron met Jen. She was working at the New England Anti-Vivisection Society when Aaron walked in and offered his services as an expert on mad cow disease. At the time, they felt they were quite similar. They were both wholly dedicated to overcoming injustice. And to Jen's surprise, Aaron was funny. Even when he was giving talks about veganism, he could make people laugh. He had a chart with pictures of the 7 different kinds of human poo, with descriptions of which poo was healthiest, and of course, the best poo was the poo pooed by vegans. Aaron and Jen moved in together, and then the trouble started. For one thing, Aaron was messy, not just untidy, dirty. Laundry would pile up in his room, dishes in the sink. He would make huge batches of food to save money, pounds and pounds of lentil stew or hummus, and leave crusted with pans and bowls all over the kitchen. When she complained, he told her that time spent washing dishes was time spent working for animal rights, which were more important. She couldn't think of a good counterargument to that. In fact, she thought he was right from a moral point of view. So all she could do and she felt herself going crazy, pressed to the brink by the filth in the kitchen, was, "But I need it, I want it, I'm asking you." Years later, she would wish she had thought to yell at him, "You know what? It is all about balance, and we live in an imperfect world, and you're right. Doing these dishes will take away from the animals. Do the fucking dishes before I have a nervous breakdown." But back then, she was young, and she wasn't sure what was right or normal or what she deserved. What killed her, too, was that she'd always thought of herself as an extremely ethical person, and now she felt like the selfish one, the bourgeois one. Dishes? When animals were being tortured and people were starving? Dishes? Jen came from a terrible family. Her mother had been raised in an orphanage and got pregnant when she was very young. Her father had owned a garage and made quite a bit of money, but then he became a violent alcoholic and lost it all. As a child, Jen was molested by both her father and her 2 brothers. When she told her mother about the abuse and that she was thinking about suicide, her mother told her she understood, and if Jen wanted to kill herself, she should go ahead. All through school, she worked for money to help her mother with the rent, and during college, she sometimes recycled cans for money. She started racking up credit card debt. But she believed in the women's movement, so when she graduated, instead of trying to get a high-paying job, she went to work for a battered women's shelter for practically nothing. Still, with her history, Jen felt like if she wanted to make herself feel better by buying a pair of shoes occasionally, that was okay. She was careful with money, but Aaron was so much more so that he made her feel guilty. He kept the heat down low in the middle of winter. He whittled his spending down to $24,000 a year, then to $12,000 a year, then to $9,000. Jen worked hard, but Aaron was always working, and work always came first. He felt that there was so much suffering in the world. He felt it almost physically. How could he stop? Sometimes, how could he relax and watch TV with his girlfriend when people were starving? Sometimes she thought he was right to do that, but sometimes she thought she, as his girlfriend, deserved special treatment, that people owed more to those they were close to than to strangers. Sometimes they would discuss this issue philosophically. Suppose there were two people drowning over there, Jen would ask, and I was drowning over here, what should you do? These discussions always ended badly. His activism, she realized, was the other woman in their relationship, and one with which she could never compete. The only time he was fully there for her was when she was in a crisis so awful that he felt it justified diverting his attention. When her father died, she was scared to go to the funeral because her two brothers, who had molested her, would be there. But Aaron took care of her. The day of the funeral, he helped her get dressed because she was so numb she could barely move. He put aside his dislike of religion to say Kaddish with her because she didn't want to pray alone. At a certain point, Jen discovered to her astonishment that Aaron had money. Not a huge amount, but a trust fund that was his to do what he liked with. She asked him to pay her credit card debt. It didn't make any sense financially for them, the two of them, to be paying all this money in interest, but more than that, it was driving her out of her mind to be in debt after all these years. She was terrified of poverty, traumatized by her period of homelessness. She and her mother were homeless for a few months. But he wouldn't pay it. He told her there were other people who needed that money more. He told her she was well-fed and had a place to live and there were people in the world who were starving. He had already allocated the money to charity. It was blood money in Aaron's eyes. His mother's father had started a company that made fur coats. Its taint could only be expunged by spending it to alleviate the worst kinds of suffering. They got married in 1999. Jen spent the morning of the wedding throwing up. The marriage lasted 2 years. One of the hardest parts of the breakup for Jen was that she now had to admit to herself that she was not the ethical person she thought she was. She was not just leaving Aaron. She was choosing selfishness. She was choosing her own survival over the happiness of other creatures. She could not justify it. She thought it was the wrong thing to do, but she couldn't help herself. She was not him. For a while, it was awful. And then bit by bit, all the resentment and misery she'd been repressing during the years she and Aaron had been together built up to a point where it exploded, and she rebelled. She and Aaron had been rigorously vegan for years, and now Jen ate cheese. She went to Paris and gorged herself on cheese. She went shopping for clothes that were new. She drank alcohol for the first time in her life. She stopped recycling. Aaron, meanwhile, steered hard in the other direction. After he and Jen split up, he didn't have a place to live for nearly a year. He put the word out that he was willing to come and speak about veganism or nutrition or animal rights or social justice to anyone who would have him for free as long as they paid his fare and put him up for the night, even if it was sleeping on someone's floor. At first, he was ecstatic. Now, after all the years of guilt living with Jen, he was free at last to devote himself completely to his activism. He earned nothing and he spent nothing. He was constantly on the move. But after about 8 months of this, he decided that enough was enough. He wanted a home again. He interviewed for a job at an animal rights organization. The same day, he found a tiny, dingy apartment above a furniture store and rented it on the spot. At the animal rights organization, he found his people. At last, he was working with people as self-denying and morally driven as he was. But sometimes he wondered about all the other people out there who didn't worry about suffering. How could they justify that to themselves? How could they ignore the misery and unfairness in the world, he wondered? How could they not help? I started this book project with the same question. Why don't people give more than they do? And this is a real puzzle, because giving is pleasurable. We all know that giving something, even something small, a little bit of money, a seat on the bus, or something large, a lot of money, or one of your kidneys, can make you happier than keeping it. So it's a real puzzle, even if we only care about our own pleasure, why we don't give more. And the usual answer is, we're human, we're weak-willed, we're lazy, we're selfish, we're too attached to our material comforts to give them up. There are also some reasons specific to giving money to foreign aid charities, such as poverty or injustice feels futile, feels insoluble, so giving feels futile. Aid money is often wasted and sometimes harms the countries it's supposed to help, and so on. And all of this is true, but it's not the whole story. One reason for living an ethical life is to do something, usually to help other people. Another reason is to be something, to become a certain sort of person yourself. And in the past couple of hundred years, but especially in the 20th century, both these reasons have come under increasingly hostile scrutiny. First, it came to seem that helping people was much more difficult and liable to backfire disastrously than had been previously thought. And then the motives for helping people came to seem much more complicated and suspect than they had before. The result is that living an ethical life has come to seem less appealing, or at least less straightforwardly so, than it once did. For instance, in the 18th century, Adam Smith in The Wealth of Nations argued that a man pursuing his own selfish ends, in combination with many other people doing the same thing, could end up working as effectively for the public good as if he'd been doing so on purpose. "He intends only his own gain," Smith wrote, "and he is, in this, led by an invisible hand to promote an end which was no part of his intention." Now, Smith only used the term invisible hand once in passing, but his metaphor proved so resonant and so enduringly popular that it implanted deep in Western culture the idea that individual selfishness could be beneficial for society as a whole, which in turn suggested that if the moral goal was helping others, as opposed to self-perfection, a selfish man might do better than a selfless one. Not long after The Wealth of Nations was published came the French Revolution, and after that came the Terror. The revolutionary leader Robespierre became known both for his moral purity and for his extraordinary violence, and partly through him, the two became indissolubly associated. After the Communist Revolution in Russia reinforced this association, it was no longer possible to see a man who believed he knew how to bring about a better world and was prepared to sacrifice himself for it without thinking of death. A century after The Wealth of Nations, Darwin's Origin of the Species introduced the idea that the selfish struggle for survival was the basis for life itself. Darwin himself believed in altruism. He believed that self-sacrificing behavior had come about through natural selection, because human survival was better ensured by groups of people prepared to sacrifice for one another than by selfish individuals, groups that cooperated, prospered, and could defeat those that did not. But to many people who believed in the Darwinian scheme, this rationale sounded contrived and unconvincing. Around the same time, the philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche argued that the Christian idea of goodness, humility, compassion, devotion to others at the expense of oneself, was a morality for the weak. Greatness could thrive only if it were selfish. So the idea that selfishness might be more effective at doing good than selflessness arose first. It was followed in the 20th century by the idea that trying to help other people might not only be ineffective, but something even more insidious, something twisted, something aggressive, something perverse. For instance, in his 1925 book, The Gift, the French anthropologist Marcel Mauss argued that giving was never quite what it purported to be. In the archaic societies that Mauss studied, giving without expectation of return was not thought to be a higher, more selfless act. Quite the contrary, it was aggressive. It set the giver up as superior to the recipient, causing the recipient to lose face. It imposed a burden of gratitude without permitting the relief of reciprocation. In some ancient languages, he wrote, the word gift had a second meaning, poison. Freud believed that while a certain amount of moral feeling was normal and necessary, an excess of virtue might indicate a pathological masochism. These thinkers led the way. For much of the 20th century, altruism was regarded in the human sciences with deep suspicion. But this suspicion of do-gooders existed not only among intellectuals, but in popular culture as well. In the 1930s, Alcoholics Anonymous popularized the idea that what had once been a sin, drunkenness, was actually a disease. Some years later, Al-Anon, a group started by the spouses of alcoholics, spread the idea that what had once been a virtue, trying to get a drunk to stop drinking, was actually a symptom of the same disease. These were both radical innovations, but the second had further-reaching moral effects. After all, whether alcoholism is a disease or a sin, either way it's undesirable. But if certain kinds of helping, particularly the entangled, tormented, devoted helping of a drunk's long-suffering spouse, were also undesirable, then that made a whole realm of moral behavior look startlingly different. Over the decades that followed, this founding idea of Al-Anon, that certain kinds of helping can be a disease that cripples both the helper and the helpee, spread from the families of alcoholics to very different situations. When the Austrian social critic Ivan Illich attacked the moral delusions of the aid worker in 1968, he did so in language that could have been taken from Al-Anon. And this is what he said. "If you insist on working with the poor, if this is your vocation, then at least work among the poor who can tell you to go to hell. It is incredibly unfair for you to impose yourselves on a village where you are so linguistically deaf and dumb that you don't even understand what you are doing or what people think of you. And it is profoundly damaging to yourselves when you define something that you want to do, as good, a sacrifice, and help. I am here to challenge you to recognize your inability, your powerlessness, and your incapacity to do the good which you intended to do." End of quote. Finally, in the 1970s, a term was coined that would take the moral ideas of Al-Anon and spread them much more widely throughout the culture: codependency. Codependent described anyone who is preoccupied by helping, or, as its advocates put it, controlling somebody else's behavior. The suspicions of Freud had merged with the teachings of Al-Anon, and selflessness had become tainted and suspect. By the middle years of the 20th century, then, this loosely related set of ideas about morality had established themselves in Western culture, that selfishness sometimes brings about more good than altruism, that altruism is often just selfishness in disguise, and that altruism can be unconsciously hostile and or a disease as ruinous as addiction. But there's yet another realm in which extreme do-gooders are undermined, and that's fiction, particularly in modern novels. Now, this is odd because many novelists are driven by moral rage, but most such novelists will rather show the thing that enrages them rather than show a character that tries to fix it. Now, you could say that do-gooders are pretty rare in real life, and so their rarity in realistic fiction is not surprising. But while in life they are unusual, in fiction they're almost non-existent. Real people are bad, but fictional people are worse. There is a sense in much fiction that the more a character cares for people far away, the less he will love his family, and the more he will find himself removed from ordinary human life. In fiction, moral intensity and a devotion to abstract ideals are often regarded with suspicion, as if they were inimical to ordinary decency and human fellowship. "I hate the idea of causes," E.M. Forster wrote in 1938. "If I had to choose between betraying my country and betraying my friend, I hope I should have the guts to betray my country." There are very few do-gooders in fiction. Many singularly good fictional characters are childlike innocents rather than do-gooders, characters like Dostoevsky's holy fool, Prince Mishkin, and the idiot. And many of the do-gooder characters that do exist have a crucial flaw that ensures that no one can take them seriously. Either they're personally repellent, like Walter in Jonathan Franzen's Freedom, or they're weak and die young, like George Bernanos's Country Priest, or else they're so completely ridiculous that they make nonsense of the whole do-gooder enterprise, like Mrs. Jellyby in Bleak House. George Eliot introduced Dorothea in Middlemarch as a foundress of nothing, who, despite a certain spiritual grandeur, failed to achieve anything significant. There are exceptions, of course, such as the heroic Dr. Rieu in Camus' novel, The Plague. But it's striking that many of these exceptionally good characters go out of their way to scorn do-gooders and to reject ethical ambition. When they perform their good deeds, they say they're merely doing their jobs. Rieu says, "Heroism and sanctity don't really appeal to me. What interests me is being a man." Tolstoy was an exception among novelists. In his early years, he was known as a naturalist, an anti-moralist, an aesthete. But in later years, Tolstoy came to feel a kind of puritanical revulsion against art for the very qualities that he'd valued in it when he was young. It was on these grounds that he wrote an attack on Shakespeare. If you haven't read this, it's amazing. The plays represented without judgment, Tolstoy felt, and observed without conclusion. In Shakespeare's world, he thought, there were no moral principles that held true in all situations, because human life in its infinite complexity did not admit of certitude. The only thing one could be reasonably sure of was that moderation was good, aspiration was bad or ridiculous or both, and if you behaved more or less like everybody else, you wouldn't go far wrong. Shakespeare, Tolstoy wrote, preached a reasonable mean natural to man between Christian and heathen precepts of love towards one's enemies on one hand and hatred towards them on the other. Thus, excessive generosity ruins Timon, while Antonio's moderate generosity confers honor. Shakespeare taught that one can be too good. Among the more startling moments in Tolstoy's railings against Shakespeare was his claim that Uncle Tom's Cabin was a better work of literature than any Shakespeare play because it flowed from the love of God and man. This claim was particularly scandalous because Uncle Tom's Cabin was such a lowbrow book, a sentimental bestseller whose literary merits were rarely defended. But if Tolstoy was going to make an argument against Shakespeare's amoral naturalism, the way to do it was with a lowbrow book. Because in lowbrow books, the kind of anti-moralizing literary ethos that he objected to in Shakespeare did not apply. This was indeed one of the characters that defined them as a lowbrow book. In a lowbrow book, a character could be very good or very bad, and unambiguous morals could be clearly drawn, and there was no sense of emotional propriety to restrict this flow of sentiment. A lowbrow character in a lowbrow book could try to change the world. Now, Uncle Tom's Cabin did, of course, change the world. Published in 1852, it was the best-selling book of the 19th century, and it was enormously influential in spreading the anti-slavery cause from a cadre of marginal zealots to the American public. Uncle Tom is a Christ figure, deeply pious, self-sacrificing, brave, incorruptible, loving. There were always those who hated Uncle Tom's Cabin for literary reasons, and others who hated it for racial political reasons. But when James Baldwin wrote an essay in 1949 to explain why he hated the book, he argued that its racism and its literary failures were one and the same. In overlooking, denying, evading a man's complexity, he wrote, we are diminished and we perish. It's only within this web of ambiguity, paradox, this hunger, danger, darkness, that we can find ourselves and the power that will free us from ourselves. It's this power of revelation which is the business of the novelist, this journey towards a more vast reality which must take precedence over all other claims. This is the novel's anti-do-gooder ethos at its most passionate. On the one hand, there is complexity and life and feeling, and on the other hand, there's moralizing and violence. In this scheme, infinite complexity can seem like the only good, the only kind of truth, and Hamlet is the only hero. All action begins to look like violence, and all principles like lies. All people must be novelists or murderers. No writer was more driven by moral rage than Baldwin, and in his nonfiction, he describes that rage and the institutions that provoke it. But in his novels, as in many literary fictions, this rage is transfigured, as though something about the form compels a different way of expressing what's wrong and what's right and what a man should do. Moral beauty in his fiction becomes smaller, more concrete, more intimate. Something that's not abstract, is not directed at strangers far away, but exists between one person and another. Aaron loved his work at the Animal Rights Organization. So much so that after a while, he began to feel that spending an entire day each week processing lentils was not an efficient use of his time. When he was younger, he had felt that his time was basically worthless, so the thing to do was to use it to save money. Now that he was a specialist with a degree and a platform, it occurred to him that his time was not worthless anymore. He still donated about 50% of his salary, but that was no longer his focus. Before long, he had become as obsessive about time as he had about money. He began to draw up flowcharts and make lists to figure out how he could use his days most efficiently. He experimented with sleeping less, 3 hours a night, 4 hours a night, to see if he could get more work done that way. He rarely spent time with friends and never allowed himself time to sit and reflect. He knew intellectually that spending time with friends or meditating on the course of his life could be good for his work. He might learn something important or realize he ought to change his direction, but he was risk averse. If he spent time that way, he might learn something or he might not. If he spent the evening working, he knew he would get something done. Shortly after he began working at the Animal Rights Group, Aaron met Leanna, the love of his life. She worked there too. He did chickens, she did seals. She was a vegan from Waterford, Connecticut. She was nearly as frugal as he was, and she, like he, had suspected that her principles about money and other things would mean that she would always be alone. She had decided when she was 13 that it was unethical to have children, and she had never changed her mind. In some ways, she was even more ascetic than he was. She cared more about the environment than he did, and so when they moved together to a building where the heat and air conditioning were included in the rent, he indulged himself in this free resource, but she shut off the vents in her room and froze or sweltered, depending on the season. After several years at the Animal Rights Organization, things started to go really, really well. Aaron had a hand in bringing about a number of big, significant victories for chickens, both legislative and corporate. Several huge companies, Safeway, Bon Appetit, and Costco, among others, promised to purchase humanely raised poultry. Starbucks promised to use only cage-free eggs. California passed a law mandating that egg-laying chickens be given almost 70% more space to live in and forbidding the sales from battery-caged hens elsewhere. American meat consumption had begun dropping nearly every year, which nobody had expected. Consumption had been going up and up and up since the 50s, but after all this time, the message, his message, that meat was bad for you, was finally getting through. Entire public school systems had taken on meatless Mondays. He realized it was silly to despair because people weren't becoming vegans. Most people were never going to become vegans, or even vegetarians, but if they ate less and less meat, then little by little, things for animals were going to get better. Sometimes he let himself hope that the whole country was turning his way. Nobody wanted to see chickens tortured, and it was getting harder and harder to deny the awfulness of industrial agribusiness. Sometimes he felt that he was on the cusp of a kind of civil rights movement for poultry that would build and build until a point, maybe even in his lifetime, when the dreadful practices of family farms would seem as repellent and unimaginable as slavery. When he felt this way, he felt that he was doing good work, had done good work, and he felt the sense of guilt and ineradicable debt that had driven him when he was younger, ease. He still needed to accumulate a certain number of utility points each day to feel okay with himself, to feel that he'd done his duty. But since his work was going so well, those points were easier to come by. It had never occurred to him when he was younger that there might come a point in his life when he felt that he was doing enough. Mostly this was a good feeling, but he was also suspicious of it. What if the lesson of his effectiveness was not that he deserved to kick back a little now, but that he was obliged to work harder than ever, now that he was getting more done? That would be more logical. What if this sense of achievement was an illusion? What if he was just getting soft and complacent, as people so often did when they got older? It was not as though the world were fixed. There were still millions of people starving, and life was still horrific for most animals. He still felt the enormous weight of that suffering, a horror that existed just outside the door of his mind, and to open that door, even a chink, was to see how hideous and infinite the suffering was. He'd always looked to the 60s, his parents' decade, as a time when many people were inspired into activism and rejected selfishness. But then he thought, what happened to all those people? Where did they slink off to at right about the age that he was now? They weren't activists anymore. No doubt they told themselves some story about how making money and having a family were natural, and the 60s were a long time ago. He was pretty sure that wouldn't happen to him, but probably they'd all thought that. Maybe there was some biological thing that happened to people at a certain age. The odd thing was that he was happy. He loved his job because he was doing work that only he could do. He was stacking up victories one after the other. He was in love with a woman who didn't need from him more than he could give her. And he had joked with a couple of his closest activist friends that if they saw him getting too easy on himself and neglecting his duty, rather than let him get old and complacent, they should take a pillow and smother him to death. Thank you.
Thank you very much for a fantastic talk.
Thank you.
Feel free to answer any question that you would like me to answer or ask. How has your relationship with the topic changed as you work through this?
That's a very interesting question. I think I started out this project really on sides. I was very, as I told you in the beginning, startled and then kind of appalled by this instinctive pathologization of these very good people. I wanted to reject that and just say, this is nonsense. We are the crazy ones for thinking that you must be crazy to do something something very good. And I still believe that. I mean, I cherry pick the people in my book. I don't think any of them are crazy. I think they're all doing great work and they're not crazy. I'm sure there are some crazy do-gooders out there, but not these guys. However, in looking at psychological theories about do-gooders, there are some that did strike me. So I was reading about a theory of the parentified child. And this is a theory that a child with at least one non-functional parent, either because they're an alcoholic or they're mentally ill, or for some reason they're just not serving as a parent, that child may come to feel that all that's messed up in his family is his fault, or at least that he needs to fix it. And so he tries to become perfect. He maybe tries to become the perfect student. He takes care of the people in his family, both the kids younger than him and even the adults. He tries to clean up and take care of the house. And the idea is that this child may grow up as an adult to have an outsized sense of moral duty. And when I first heard about this, I thought, ugh, this is another, you know, pathologizing psychological theory and, you know, bah. But then I thought about the people in my book and I thought, almost all of them have a parent that's either alcoholic or mentally ill. That's quite striking. And now, mind you, these people were not selected scientifically and I'm not making any scientific claims whatsoever, but that was striking and I thought maybe there was something to that theory. On the other hand, then I was thinking, well, okay, maybe having a bad family situation when you're growing up can produce in you a sense of moral duty. But then think about another child who has a very good situation growing up, two wonderful parents who teach him to help others, and he also grows up with a sense of moral duty. I don't think that one is more or less free or true than the other. So even though I think this theory may have something to it, I reject the idea that that means that the sense of duty experienced by such people is somehow compelled and therefore unreal. Yeah.
I think you wrote in a chapter in the book and then in a New York article recently about a family that adopted a number of children. Mm-hmm. And something I was struck by when I read the article was that it seemed like their biological children ended up having sort of better outcomes than the adopted children in some ways, and sort of like they ended up with higher paying jobs or they didn't have kids early in life. So it's not about your talk tonight, but I'm curious, like, How did they feel about that? Was that something they thought about? It didn't seem like that came through in the book.
They, the biological children, or are they the parents?
The parents.
Okay.
But also just like, how do you feel about that? Because it doesn't come through in the chapter.
Well, first of all, I should correct that a little bit, that there was really only one. This is a couple who had two biological kids and adopted 20 special needs kids. Special needs in the adoption context, which means very unlikely to be adopted. So for instance, they adopted six teenagers who did not have mental or physical disabilities, but no one else was going to adopt six teenagers, but they wanted to keep the family together. And it's actually not the case that the bio kids are doing best in worldly terms. There's only one of them who's really, a big worldly success, which is one of the adopted kids who works as a banker in Switzerland, and he earns a ton of money, and none of the rest of them really do. But the moral problem faced by them was similar to that faced by all of the people in my book, which was the conundrum of how much do I give to family and how much do I give to strangers. But with them, it was stranger. It was an odder form of it because they were dealing with strangers who then became family. So they started out thinking, we're going to have two children and adopt two. But then they felt, well, there are more than two children in the world that need parents. And they adopted some more, and then some more, and then some more. And as the family got bigger and the children got older, they would have family meetings about whether or not they should bring more kids into the family. And as the family grew bigger, some of the kids would say, no, we don't have enough of your time and attention as it is. There aren't enough resources. These were not wealthy people. They had very little money. And they would protest. And this cut the parents to the quick. You know, they didn't draw a distinction between bio kids and adopted kids. I mean, these are their children that they already had. But whereas most of us, I think, if we felt that we would be hurting the children we already had, that would be it. Okay, we're not going to adopt anymore. But they felt, okay, it's true that we'll deprive the children we have of some measure of time and attention and resources. But if it dramatically changes the life of a child who's still a stranger to us, it's worth it. And at a certain point, they stopped. They didn't adopt 23 kids. And I should also point out that the husband in this family came from a family of 16 biological kids. So for him, 22 kids is not as crazy sounding as it is to many people. It was normal to him. But yeah, I think, you know, people have had very different reactions to their story. Some people feel like they were presumptuous or crazy to think that they could be good parents to so many kids. And they cite as evidence the fact that there were a lot of troubles in the family. Two kids went to jail. Every single one of the girl kids became pregnant before she was married. And this, you know, this contradicted the parents' whole mission. Their whole thing was raising kids in a stable home and when you're ready to raise them. And so this really distressed them. But they created a family, and they gave parents to children who would never have had parents otherwise. And this was not an orphanage. This is a real family. And I think, in my view, yeah, you're right. I didn't give them a thumbs up or thumbs down at the end of the article. My view is it really worked. And you have to look more closely at the things that happened. You know, one of the kids who ended up in jail, they adopted him when he was 17 after an unbelievably violent and awful childhood. So, you know, he ends up in jail 2 years later. Can you really blame them for that? Like, I don't think so. Three of the kids died young, but they had, you know, fatal diseases. So, you know, they have fatal diseases, not their fault. So, I think it was a success. Many, many painful things happened. And, you know, certainly you could make the argument that had they adopted just two kids, as was their original plan when they met in high school, that those two kids would have perhaps grown up to be more successful than they did otherwise. But then there would have been 18 others who would have grown up without parents. So I think they're heroic. But many people don't think so, and that's, I find, very interesting.
Long way to the microphone. So I guess I'm interested in your thoughts on how being close to suffering or understanding suffering, proximal to suffering, plays a role. I think, you know, compassion and empathy are big buzzwords. You didn't use them once, I don't think, which is really interesting. Not a criticism, just kind of I noticed that.
Yeah.
And I've read some things, I don't remember where, that people who are in either are poor themselves or in communities that have a lot of kind of active suffering going on, actually we see higher levels of people practicing charity and volunteerism and caring for people, which I've always thought is kind of interesting. And so it just kind of makes me wonder, is there something about people becoming remote from it, like either not understanding it or feeling that they can actually make the leap and just escape it altogether, and that's kind of desirable. Right. I was just curious on your thoughts on that theme.
Yeah, that's a great question. And actually, I think that gets to the core of another thing that's very different about the people I'm writing about from regular people. First of all, I want to say you're right. There's lots of data that that says that people who are less wealthy give a higher percentage of their salary or, you know, their money to charity and time, even though, of course, that's more costly for them. So that is a very striking thing. But what I would say is that for most of us, you know, we feel moved to give mostly when we see something that needs our help, something or someone. So, you know, there's been a lot of bemoaning recently that there was a huge outpouring of compassion for this refugee crisis in Europe once we saw that photo that everyone saw in the world of that toddler drowning in the water. And so I think that's true for most people, that you feel, now I don't know if you can, you feel empathy, you feel compassion when something is presented in front of you and you're moved to help if you see someone in trouble on the street in front of you, you feel it's your responsibility, or if something's in your community or your family. And compassion and empathy are very important motivators for that kind of normal moral impulse. And I think the difference between the people I'm writing about and most of the rest of us is that they feel as strongly for something that exists only in their minds. So they know that someone is suffering, but they don't see them. There's no photograph, but they know, and it's vivid to them. It's as powerful to them. You know, some people, Aaron is relatively rational and cold about his activism, but most of the people in my book have the ability to feel the kind of emotion that we would feel if we saw someone bleeding on the ground without anyone bleeding on the ground. And I think it's a kind of vividness of imagination, a sort of aesthetic ability that contributes to their moral sense of duty. It's a kind of moral genius that enables them to experience something as vividly in the abstract as most of us need someone actual in front of us to see. And I think that's why Peter Singer's example that I mentioned briefly in the piece is so clever and so powerful, because he says, well, if you saw a child drowning in a pond in front of you and you could save him only by muddying your clothes, would you? And everyone says, well, obviously, of course, you'd be a monster not to. And then he says, aha, but you're trapped. There are millions of children drowning or dying in some other way all the time, whom you could save with the equivalent money that a muddied pair of pants would cost, but you don't do it. And that's just as bad, he claims. And that's a pretty powerful argument. Yeah.
It is a powerful argument. Thank you for writing about this, and thank you for coming to speak about it. A couple
thank
of
you.
Like slightly personal questions. What first brought you to this topic? And how frustrating was it for you personally as you were going through the process of researching and writing about it? And then finally, do you have any hope that we as a society can someday popularize idealism? Or is it too big?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it's funny. I've been recently having conversations about, a friend of mine wrote a paper questioning the tax credit for charitable donations, because in effect it's a subsidy for rich people's the things that rich people want to give to, because you only get a tax deduction if you are past a certain level of income, and wealthy people often give to institutions like the opera or concert halls that are not available to ordinary people, or to churches, which obviously are just for a certain people. Anyway, so I've been having a lot of conversations, and many, many people, to my astonishment, say, well, of course, no one would ever give to charity if you removed the charitable deduction. which I think is incredible. I mean, I just don't think that's true, but many people seem to think it's true, so maybe it is. I hope not. I mean, it's not as though with a deduction you end up with a profit. You know, it's you're still giving money away. So I don't know. I mean, I think I tend to think that people are less selfish than we think they are. And that's part of the reason I wanted to spend so much time in the book analyzing what is going on with our sense that there's something wrong with people who are unselfish. Because I think that part of the reason people tend to be selfish is because they think people are selfish. People behave according to what is expected of them. And it occurred to me that, you know, I was trying to think of how to explain why I think these do-gooders are normal. And I thought, well, in a certain kind of wartime or in a crisis, the things that seem normal to do-gooders all the time come to seem normal to everybody. So one of the most of us go around thinking most of the time we're living in ordinary times, we just go about our business. But if there was a tsunami or an earthquake or a war, suddenly everyone would feel obliged to help the community. And you know, a person who went off to war to defend his country, abandoning his family in the process, would not seem abnormal, would seem just patriotic. And someone who, you know, in ordinary life, if you were asked to sacrifice your life for a stranger, it seems outrageous, but in a war, it's perfectly normal. And so, again, I think for these people, it's always wartime. They always feel that sense of urgency. And I began to wonder, is there some connection between our sense that it's normal to be selfish and care only about your family and the absence of the draft? Because now, obviously, in Vietnam, there was a draft, but that was a bad war that many people disapproved of. And so it didn't have the feeling of being drafted for something worthy. So it's been a very long time since World War II, since there's been a draft in this country for something that many people considered a just war, a good war. It's been a very long time since people have had the experience of being expected, as a matter of course, to give up a lot for something bigger than themselves. And I wonder if that has an effect on what people expect and what they consider normal. I think it probably does.
Hi, I had a question sort of following up about, you mentioned the sort of one parent alcohol or crazy that ran through these individuals in your book. Was there any other sort of motivating factor that you found sort of drove people to that level of, you know, to a level that made them so selflessness, and also I'm curious about the parenting aspect of it too. Was there anything in common with the parents of these people that mm-hmm. kind of instilled in them this moral sort of higherness?
I think, you know, for most of them, it wasn't that they felt they should do something extraordinary. They consider it normal. So, you know, just as you don't pat yourself on the back if you go to a store and you leave without stealing a single thing, that's how they feel. You know, the puzzle for them is, why doesn't anyone else feel this way? How can other people not do what we do? They don't think what they're doing is extraordinary. And in terms of parenting, apart from that one dysfunctional parent, I don't really see any commonalities. But I read something that was very striking in terms of parenting. I read Samuel and Pearl Oliner were sociologists who wrote about... Samuel Oliner had survived the Holocaust as a teenager. He was hidden by a Catholic woman who took him in and taught him to pass as Catholic, and that's how he survived the war. And they made a study of people who rescued Jews during the Holocaust and people who didn't, and tried to figure out why, what's the difference between these two people, sets of people. And they're very fascinating studies, and there's lots of differences. But the one that stuck in my mind as a parent, I thought, was that the ones who didn't rescue had often been raised in very strict traditional households, which gave them the sense that they gave him a feeling of powerlessness, that they were just supposed to obey and do what they were told by their parents and keep their heads down and not, you know, not shake things up. Whereas the ones who rescued had been raised in much more lenient households by parents who allowed them much more freedom, and thus gave them a sense that they had a sense of power, that they could affect things, that if they tried to make something right, they could do it. And I thought that was very striking because, you know, often it's part of our panoply of cliches about moral people that morality is a matter of being strict and obedient and, you know, towing the line and obeying the rules. And so I thought it was sort of fascinating that in this case, it seemed as though the opposite were true, that the doing the right thing arose from a sense of freedom.
I think we only have time for one or two more questions. Thank you.
Okay. I may have to give me a little slack on getting this question organized, but it appears that there's a lot of propaganda against being idealistic or whatever. And what do you think of this hypothesis our social system is set up it doesn't really guarantee a really nice safety net for when we fall on hard times, and therefore people end up, some people will work really, really hard to amass wealth so that they don't fall into poverty. And part of that may involve putting out propaganda for people to be selfish and be like super consumers, thus to support this the people who are actually able to affect the opinions in society. Anyway.
Well, it's interesting that you bring up the sort of societal safety net because I'm for societal safety nets. On the other hand, Americans who have much less of one than people do in Europe give much more to charity than Europeans do. And I don't think that's because Americans are innately more generous. I think it's because there's a sense in Europe that certain areas of taking care of people is something the government needs to do. And it's the government's province. And that if society is properly organized, we pay taxes and the government takes care of its poor and its sick and et cetera. So, you know, while I wholeheartedly admire the people in this book, it's certainly true that in some sense the impulse to save the world on your own is a politically conservative one rather than, say, devoting your time to working for a situation in which the government would take on more of those functions.
My question is not related to this book. You've written a few very brilliant profiles for The New Yorker.
Thank you.
I wanted to ask you, how do you go about choosing your subjects, and can you tell us a little bit about how you research and write those profiles?
I choose subjects, I mean, there's no method, but one thing I do try to do is write only about people I admire, because I make an exception for politicians. I think it's fine to write a piece about a politician you think is loathsome, but I think, you know, profiles, especially for The New Yorker, they're really long and they take a lot of interviewing, and so it just feels terrible to go into that in bad faith. So I try to do my best to read enough of the person. Usually it's someone who's some kind of thinker or writer often that I've written about, read their work beforehand to make sure that I don't have to wholeheartedly admire it and think they're perfect genius or anything, but there has to be something really, really interesting, because what I want to do is answer really two questions. One is, why are they so good at what they do? What is it about them that makes them so good? And the second thing is why they fell in love with a certain kind of set of ideas. You know, what I'm trying to do, you know, it's cheesy to make simplistic connections between biography and work, but I do think that it can be enlightening. So, for instance, one person I read about not too long ago is the philosopher, the Oxford philosopher Derek Parfit, and I thought it was fascinating. He's an atheist and a utilitarian philosopher whose obsession is to prove that moral rules exist in reality in the same way that mathematical rules do, that they're not relative, that they're not invented, that they're not different, the difference between morality between people is just a mistake, and that actually somewhere, even if we can't figure out what they are, there do exist rules that are real and true. And I thought that, you know, I can't add to professional philosophers' analysis of his work. I'm not a professional philosopher, so they're going to be able to do that better than me. But I thought what I could add was details of his life that illuminate to my mind what he writes about. And so I thought it was interesting that his parents were both members of something called the Oxford Group, which was this very, very intense missionary organization in England in the 20s and 30s. Actually, it was the group from which Alcoholics Anonymous emerged. And it believed in principles like absolute truth, absolute love, absolute honesty, and there was a fourth one, absolute something else. And that they were these extremely devout missionaries. And I thought, you know, that's an example of something that is enlightening and sheds light on the way he approaches philosophy, even if he himself is an avowed atheist. So thank you very, very much for coming. Thank you.